Pick a genre. Take one movie from each decade from the 1930s on, and let's compare. The one rule, I've never seen the movies before. Let's look at conspiracy thrillers. It's difficult to find a proper conspiracy thriller before 1960. The whole idea of conspiracies in the real world didn't emerge until after the Warren Report in the US in 1964. Before that, what you have are spy thrillers or individuals plotting and planning and driving people to the edge. Fritz Lang made the most notable early entry into this category with Dr. Mabuse the Gambler in 1922. The evolution of Dr. Mabuse through to the 1960s helped create so many of the tropes we see in conspiracy movies, as well as numerous spy subgenres. In English language cinema, the one at the forefront was Alfred Hitchcock. The 39 Steps is a spy movie, really. Based on the novel by John Buchan and starring Robert Donat and Madeleine Carroll, it relies on panic and potential espionage of military secrets as Europe once again harbours potentially deadly enemies. The conspiracy emerges as exposition in the finale and not particularly central to the actual plot. A man acquires secret information, then is on the run from the police. It's a theme that would bode well for Hitchcock's career. The key elements are the innocent man on the run, the keeping of secrets and outing of conspirators, moles and double agents. The reveal of the severity of the information is thrown straight at you in the second scene, after the first cleverly sets up a bookend for the finale. It's a good spy film and it holds up against others, including numerous remakes. Whereas the 30s could play on potential fear of an upcoming war and loss of advantage, the 40s plunged conspiracy right into the war. But given the savage use of conspiracy theories in Nazi propaganda, Hollywood didn't want to follow such attacks. Instead, the conspirators are working for the war effort, spies and undergrounds, resistances and rebels. In 1944's The Conspirators, Paul Henreid all but recreates his resistance fighter Victor Laszlo from Casablanca. With no Humphrey Bogart to take the limelight, if not the girl, here Henreid leads the pack with Hedy Lamarr. Peter Lorre and Sidney Greenstreet follow from Casablanca for a film noir spy thriller. Unfortunately, those elements don't help Jean Nicolesco's film get beyond a well-acted pile of trash. It's just a mess. The conspiracy is ultimately who is conspiring with the Nazis against the anti-Nazi conspirators. And it's the person working for the Nazis, obviously. So the twist is bad, although you almost forgive that, because the reveal scene is a brilliant idea. All the actors are around a roulette table, a ruse, goodies and baddies, and us in the know with only the hero and wise man character. Unfortunately, this movie decides to explain explicitly every step, and despite the odd good shot, refuses to explain fully through images instead. And a tease should have been the reveal, making it more complex. Gestures instead of obvious choices. It's just complete lack of subtlety in this scene, which really would have benefited the film. So the reveal is made of the conspirator, the Nazi sympathizer in the ranks, and we have a terrible chase sequence. All the subtlety and subtext and beauty and character of Casablanca is lost in a story where the conspiracy tension is no one pays any fucking attention to anything, and when they're all supposed to be spies. The 1950s left the Nazi propaganda in the past and focused fully on the communists. Hitchcock loved his spies and taking the audience for a ride, and he would do it again and again. He even corrected his own efforts with a remake of The Man Who Knew Too Much. Jimmy Stewart is the Hitchcockian everyman in Morocco who learns too much. The innocent man on the run. The conspiracy revolves around the murder of a prime minister of a fake European country, and Jimmy gets caught up in it. But it adds an element to the conspiracy movie that will continue henceforth, and that is the man who has no idea what the fuck is going on. Earlier it was spies, or Hitchcock telling his everyman at the beginning what was happening. Here, Stewart learns it slowly, and we along with him. We only learn the full truth in the final act, with hints throughout, but the real trick is the slow trickle of severity. Here, Jimmy learns on the phone of the immense personal stakes of the caper. Hitchcock masterly structures the piece, and was right to insist on Doris Day as Stewart's wife, distraught over the kidnapping of her son. She's most famous for singing and comedy. Here, Day fucking nails it.
You gave me sense! Oh,
shut up.
Go, why didn't you tell me?
She plays a pained, mother, struggling to cope, desperate. The studio was wrong to question her choice. She makes the film work, as Stewart is fine as himself, his usual stuff. But Hitchcock the Master, at work with Doris Day on her day, makes it a great film. And the conspiracy, fear of plots, build up in the 50s, and here it's pulling in a bunch of elements like government, church, police, and a wonderful concert hall finale. The 1960s saw the communist paranoia of US officials like Joseph McCarthy taking on a different tone. Where McCarthy had blundered on about communist conspirators in the US right up to his censure in 1954 and death in 1957, the movies now focused more on not so much the threat of communist infiltrators, like Hollywood screenwriters, but on general fanaticism. The movies changed with the release of John Frankenheimer as the Manchurian Candidate in 1962, where an American soldier is captured and hypnotized to become a political assassin with the help of his evil mother, brilliantly played by Angela Lansbury. Our hero there, Frank Sinatra, is a victim of the plot rather than an everyman caught up in it, or necessarily an innocent man on the run. He has the connections in the military to foil the plot. A similar hero appears in Frankenheimer's 7 Days in May. This time Kirk Douglas plays our career soldier savior, choosing to play second billing to get Burt Lancaster to play the zealot conspirator. And what a choice, because Lancaster nails it. Convincing as someone who can convince others of treason, in this case to take over the airwaves and oust a liberal president for his nuclear disarmament treaty. Douglas stumbles on the plot and goes through all the proper channels to solve this crisis, making this a very much pro-American democracy film, with high-ranking US official villains thwarted. The film is set in 1974, so acts as a warning against potential issues, either zealotry or partisanship. It works well on this front as a diverse group of actors work together to stop Lancaster's general. And it takes its time to explain the important elements, not in bland exposition like the conspirators, but through the use of excellent actors, much like Hitchcock did in The Man Who Knew Too Much. It isn't just Lancaster and Douglas nailing it, but Ava Gardner adds excellent elements of moral ambiguity to proceedings, and Frederick March as the president is wonderfully convicted and true. It makes for a ponderous film full of contemplation, but worthily and rightfully so. By the 70s and the result of the Watergate scandal, which saw the impeachment and resignation of President Nixon, the pro-democracy idea was replaced with a deep-seated pessimism. All the President's Men, The Parallax View, and 3 Days at the Condor capture the cynicism best, with Sidney Pollack's 3 Days at the Condor depicting groups within the CIA killing their own to hide their covert, criminal, and wide-sweeping operations. So Robert Redford plays a CIA desk worker who reads books from around the world in search of potential codes and leaks, and he is damn good at his job, so he breaks the rules, including the less secure back door to his office. This saves him as he nips out for lunch and returns to find everyone dead, shot by a group led by eerie, foreign-looking Max von Sydow. So Redford is the innocent man on the run again, but instead of Jimmy Stewart inching towards resolution, here Redford is beaten down again and again. Whenever he may be on the right track, something just totally sideswipes him. When we finally get to a point of solution, Redford telling his story to a newspaper, revealing the truth to the world, the movie gives you one last punch to the gut and says, "Nope, sorry, and also fuck you for trying." Von Sydow's assassin's monologue explains the real truth of the film. Narcissism is the way forward. Forget about it. It's all too corrupt to salvage. This pessimism wasn't just in conspiracy movies, but it spread throughout audiences and artists for the following decade and allowed for the 1980s descent into neoliberal selfishness and individualism. Although Pollack denied his film was taking advantage of the contemporaneous news of the CIA's family jewels scandal, it does work as a clear emblem of the mood of the time. The 1980s took this cynicism and, barring some 70s-style conspiracy movies like Silkwood or No Way Out, went for a more fantastical sense. Notably, They Live with their aliens and 1984's dystopian future. There were still some movies clinging to this Cold War conspiracy idea. In Britain, a sense of Thatcherism and fatigue from the Cold War led to films like Defense of the Realm. A newspaper man played by Gabriel Byrne follows a story and discovers how close Britain came to nuclear disaster on an American airbase and the murders committed to cover it up. It keeps the cynicism of the 1970s films and adds the mistrust of Thatcher and their special relationship with the USA, trumping law and order and morality. Gabriel Byrne's protagonist, Nick, is really just following the story for his own selfish needs, using shady journalistic tricks along the way, but the truth and the death of his colleague, brilliantly played by Denham Elliott, drag him into a moral stance. It's kind of taking the 80s selfishness and running with that as if that would be a valid way to battle a conspiracy. But they have to add a sense of morality at the end. The film fairly plods along its mystery thriller plot, but elements make it work until we finally get an ending that's both dark and cynical, but a happy, hopeful, positive epilogue. It feels almost like a cop-out, giving a sense of positivity the film and the era don't deserve. And in the 1990s, a major element was added to conspiracy movies, the internet. The Net from 1995 is a good example of how 1990s films use the internet, just throwing in a bunch of jargon, some bullshit hacker slang that sounds incredibly dated now, and lots of primitive-looking computer images. And a vital element, hackers saying aloud what they do and read on the computer.
Password. Password.
Thank you, Sandra Bullock, for explaining. Erwin Winkler's film may look dated now and follow a conspiracy plot that takes the innocent victim and sends them on the run, but it had enough 1990s tropes to feel right for the time. The old-fashioned story and tensionless action are made up for only by Bullock's penetrating charm. Much like in Speed the same year, she just seems kind of lovely, and you want her to win. Not necessarily committing brutal murder of her assailant at the end, but this is the 1990s where you can kill a bad guy however you want. With the new millennium and the Matrix as an apex of computer-based film imagery and all film, really, the tone changed. The world changed and coverage of the world changed with it, leading to a revival of a certain type of conspiracy movie, the whistleblower film. Whereas Robert Redford had been the journalist in All the President's Men, and journalism films are still made, and A Man They Want to Kill in 3 Days of the Condor, a subgenre that has nowhere to go after the manic direction of Enemy of the State, it was another 1970s classic that inspired the 2000s, Serpico. The insider who blows the whistle and exposes the crimes and conspiracies of, usually, corporations, and the corrupt bought politicians who defend them, and the police who exist to defend corporate interests. The totally corrupt invasion of Iraq and Afghanistan and the twisted world of Dick Cheney led to this desperation for good people speaking out, or telling stories of real-life good guys of the past. In Mike Nichols' Charlie Wilson's War, Tom Hanks plays one loathsome congressman with a heart of gold, who, despite every character in the movie being detestable, managed to do the right thing to fight the communists in Afghanistan by arming the Mujahideen. I mean, it's an anti-conspiracy film where we are in on the plot and all of it. However, knowing who these rebels would become and the damage they would do with their CIA-funded arms and training, the movie does well at luring the audience into almost forgetting. Philip Seymour Hoffman's gruff anti-spy hints at this.
You know, there's a story about a Zen master and a little boy. Yeah.
But is of course ignored by Washington and us before a finale that poses serious questions for the audience. If only the scenes of death and destruction had been so jarringly bad, this film may have been more significant. Alas, in 2007, it was hardly necessary to talk of how bad the CIA was at arming future terrorists. And how much more humane the US is compared to the Soviet Union, given what Chelsea Manning was witnessing at that time.
Biggest ever leaks of offshore secrets, 13 million documents, mostly from an offshore law firm called Appleby.
Manning released her swathe of documents in 2010, Edward Snowden revealed mass surveillance in 2013, the Panama Papers exposed the known but accepted fact of trillions hidden in offshore tax havens in 2016. By the 2010s, conspiracies were being exposed as real. And it turns out 3 Days of the Condor was right, and nothing happens, nothing changes, and the whistleblowers go to jail or on the run. The movies couldn't emulate this. Conspiracy movies continued as biopics and real-life recreations of these real-life whistleblowers. Benedict Cumberbatch playing Julian Assange, or Joseph Gordon-Levitt playing Edward Snowden. The conspiracy movie was reduced to recreation of fact, with movies often uninspiring because the truth is so disheartening. Only documentary films like Oscar winner Inside Job or the incredible work of Adam Curtis were able to make good films out of this wealth of conspiratorial corruption. Hollywood, then, decided for their fiction conspiracies to go absurd. And these stories were sent to the superhero movies like Captain America the Winter Soldier, or worse, another adaptation of a Dan Brown novel. Inferno, the third Robert Langdon movie, is a giant pile of burning garbage. Using way too many tired tropes to tell a story that doesn't make sense, with the intriguing, controversial, conspiratorial questions of the Da Vinci Code replaced with a Thanos-level catastrophic attack. At no point does the movie ever stop to think, why are we doing any of this? Jumping right into a man on the run with a twist visible from the opening shots and Tom Hanks crawling his way through the material, probably wishing he was back in a hot tub with strippers in Charlie Wilson's War. The conspiracy film is split between stories of real-life conspiracies where nothing is ultimately done about the crimes, and fantasy, where happy endings exist and plots are thwarted. How very unrealistic. This goes along with and fuels the increase in wild conspiracy theories across the internet. Because the real-life stories aren't sexy enough, they don't have a hero saving the day. The whole thing doesn't collapse just because it's been exposed, like in The Matrix or Dark City. Things carry on as is, and people can't handle that misery. So 5G and Flat Earth and nonsense like this becomes the sexy enemy you can beat conspiracy that used to be reserved for Bond villains and specific government officials, or rogue generals, or at least they can save their children like The Man Who Knew Too Much. The genre has been killed by the real-life success of conspirators and whistleblowers. Key to these films is the person who can save the day. The 70s said one man can, but when the thing is bigger, the one man needs to be unique happenstance, like Bernstein and Woodward coming together, but that is rare. What is much easier is the one. The one culminating in Neo in The Matrix. With the internet, it was the one woman hacker, Sandra Bullock. Numerous times since, the one person has been Tom Hanks. Mark Ruffalo likes to be involved too. The one is the audience and has access to the story, so we watch as they learn the truth, slow enough for us to process it. So to compare these decades more closely, we can compare the scenes where these characters discover the gravity of their situation. Looking at the 39 steps in 1935, the reveal is made early, clearly, and with little reaction. It's an exposition dump used to set up our character as someone who will not be overly phased and may just get through this. Frying some herring while they go. He's just unfortunately caught up in the situation. He then learns the potential consequences of his new knowledge as his source of information is murdered, collapsing on his bed, catching him with his pants down, or the 1930 equivalent in his layers and layers of pajamas. All this happens after just 11 minutes. In the 1940s, we have the old spy movie style, sitting around in a room, finally telling someone the truth. A nice twist of revealing the legitimacy of trust almost override the reveal of the true issue in The Conspirators. So they need to search for the mole in their resistant groups. It plays out slowly and coolly, letting the actors do their thing and unfortunately reveal the whole rest of the movie to us. The 50s saw these reveals become much more personal. One man discovering something that they then can't talk about. The telephone is perfect. It's a perfect method, and Hitchcock wonderfully takes advantage of the benefits and limitations of the technology. Jimmy Stewart reacts to the threat, the news of his son's kidnapping. We slowly get to the seriousness of it and feel it all in a close-up of Stewart's face, the camera tight. Then Hitchcock doubles down and has an acquaintance verify the call in French, which Stewart doesn't understand, so we don't understand, as the truth sinks in and his panic starts, his fingers fiddling with a phone book, a huge tome of potential voices, none of whom he can talk to. The conspiracy is against one man, and we are the only ones he can talk to. Compare that to the 60s and people speaking to senators, generals, and presidents. 7 days in May, Kirk Douglas hears offhand comments from colleagues because he's liked and trusted person. The big reveal comes from an old friend assigned to the suspicious secret base Burt Lancaster's general has set up. It is offhand, forgettable, but as the friend relates later, a glimmer on the face of Douglas, who has such a sympathetic face anyway, that these glimmers are enough. In the 1970s, we have men hunting for information. They beg, borrow, and steal all the scraps they can get and put two and two together from all of their files. Robert Redford's Turner, in 3 Days of the Condor, discovers the truth from a news report implicating him in the murder of his own friend. He reacts, thinks, works out how bad this is with the help of a photography motif. Lonely pictures, like a lonely protagonist. The scene then leans towards his desperation as he feels he can't trust Faye Dunaway, chains her to a radiator. It's a sign of our character's strength and the hopelessness of the situation. In Defense of the Realm, they labour this point of research and working things out, and then it falls back on the phone call. Calling the right person with the right fake name, getting that line that makes everything fall into place. And in a copy of The Man Who Knew Too Much, a second phone call, Gabriel Byrne can only listen as the threat, the fear, takes control of the situation. It's got this individualism of the 50s that was very prevalent in the 1980s, and still the lingering cynicism of the 1970s. In the 1990s, of course, the reveal swaps the phone wire for a modem wire, and the reveal is done through online research. Sandra Bullock helpfully explains what she is doing on the computer by muttering words like password, even saying no to help those who don't know what invalid password means. Then flashing images of computer screens and web pages and a conveniently timed, oh my god. A non-diegetic dial tone ends the sequence as a polite reminder that this was all achieved through the wonder and potential horror of the internet. Charlie Wilson's War uses two main tools for its reveal of the information. These are conspirators, but we must approve of their actions because we're in on the conspiracy. So we have Tom Hanks and we have Aaron Sorkin. So sharp, filmic dialogue from Hanks in a snappy exchange with a diplomat reveals the lengths Congressman Wilson will have to go to arm a militia and destroy Soviet helicopters. It is, like so many scenes in this film, excellently written and performed, but with little more than that. The true reveal of the consequences people in 2007 were living are hinted at, then dumped on us at a celebration at the close in a lovely little parable of the Zen master.
Listen, not for nothing, but do you know the story about the Zen master and the little boy?
So if you compare this film to 2005's The Constant Gardener, you can see the shift from the more old-fashioned slow burn. Constant Gardener does that really well because it adds 2000s filmmaking to an old, more old-fashioned story. It's a John le Carré novel. And Fernando Morales really adds a flair to it. Whereas Charlie Wilson's War goes the other way and adds the upcoming elements of fantasy and non-believable language that Aaron Sorkin writes so well. But it's taking away from the reality of it, even though this is based on a true story. By the time we reach the 2010s, all of these techniques and more are being used to relive more true stories of whistleblowers, journalists, reformed lawyers, and documentaries that use all of these. They also continue this unbelievable element that is hinted at in Aaron Sorkin's writing by making the narrative or the actions of the whistleblowers quite unbelievable. The Fifth Estate about Julian Assange does this right at the end, where it's talking about how this film was based on a book that can't really be believed as genuine fact. I think it's quite a negative twist on these to make them almost unbelievable, almost dissuading people from actually blowing the whistle. I think what happened to Harvey Weinstein is a good indication of why. So it's really only documentary film that does it in a probing way.
Give it your best shot.
To encourage better people. Although there are odd film examples that do have this positive message. But in fiction, like Inferno, none of that is needed. Just Robert Langdon getting his memory back, and the twist betrayal that everyone must have seen coming a mile off. This happens more than once and is more and more boring, but none as laboured as the oh my god, Watson knows, with voices fading into the flashbacks and everything losing focus. A movie aimed at the truly passive viewer. So over 7 decades, conspiracies have involved one innocent person against far too much, far too many, and a fight against something we can't initially comprehend. Some fought and survived, some fought and revealed plots, then most failed. Until now, when winning is a fantasy. Finally, we end up in 2019's Dark Waters, where the reveal of the truth is dull, dark, drab, and understated, because immediately after, the important truth is revealed that we can't win.
The system is rigged.
But of course, we must keep fighting. People like Rob Billet against DuPont, as depicted in Dark Waters, Chelsea Manning and Edward Snowden, countless other whistleblowers fighting for a truth against conspiratorial power. Unlike a 70s conspiracy that'll end with a freeze frame, life keeps going, so there's always more conspiracies to reveal and concoct, and always more genre movies to make. Thank you for watching. Please like and subscribe if you want to see more videos. Comment below if you have anything to add about conspiracy thrillers. I look forward to hearing what you have to say, and I'll be back with another genre analysis soon.